that cooperative compassion is being discredited, it's being abused, it's being neglected, it's being marginalized at every turn by those that control the food, the money, the gas, the communications, the information. So it's leaving people going, I don't get it. Because what they feel within their heart and what they see is needed within the society is not being supported. It's being the opposite. It's being challenged. It's being criticized. It's being abused. It's being exploited at every turn. And this is the awakening. This is what's happening. You have 50 different issues that are all part of the same issue. The real issue is, are we going to become divine, selfless beings and care and share and help? Or are we going to fight and struggle and hassle over what we perceive to be as differences? And this is what is going to make the difference. The consciousness of the humans is changing.
Hi, this is Bruce Lipton, and you're listening to Planet FM.
Kia ora, greetings, and welcome to Planet FM 104.6. I'm Tim Lynch, and I trust that you are doing well. I invite you to stay with me over the next hour as we discuss and find ways to take care of our unique and magnificent green planet Earth. On the phone at the moment from the Waikato region, I have Roy Harlow. Roy has been at the forefront of all the different things that are happening in the world today that humanity does not know about. The fact that we have got so much to learn very quickly at the moment to see what's really happening because we are not getting the media to assist us in our growth, to educate us, to allow us to realise that there's a huge shift happening. We're in the 5G movement at the moment, we've got COVID, we've got the fourth industrial revolution, we've got Agenda 21 and Agenda 2030, and we have many, many things to be able to discuss, particularly about how we can raise our consciousness above this 3D reality matrix ensnarement. So, kia ora, Roy.
Good morning to you, Tim. Thanks for having me on.
Roy, I had Billy Tikahika last week, and I'll tell you what, it was a very good interview, and we're getting thousands of people clicking on and listening to this. So, he was one person who was wanting to bring a higher consciousness to this, even though he's got to get down in the trenches from time to time to really wake up the people or wake up the government at a particular level. So, Roy, how can we have a greater knowing from a higher perspective, from a spiritual point of view?
Well, I think that we're all in the same boat as Billy, and that is we have a desire to be higher beings and express our divinity, but we're forced to be at the coal face, struggling for fairness, struggling for awareness. And at that platform, we can share what we are and what we're facing. Billy has the daunting task of lifting the consciousness of the people out of the differences and into the similarities and the unity that's actually already here. The old story of we don't have to form a movement because the human race is the movement and we're all part of it. It's a matter of understanding what we're going through and who we are and looking at what is our contribution. We come here with nothing and we leave with nothing. So what is of value is what we contribute. And so our contribution is going to be relative to our perspective of life. And the perspective of life that's being propagated is the perspective of selfishness, that we're constantly being forced into the survival concept. Nobody has enough money. Nobody has enough time. Nobody has enough friends. Nobody has enough of anything. And this restrictive standard of living, when the earth is abundant by God's grace, and where there's plenty for everyone, but it's being stolen by the few at the top, to leave us in this conception of, I have to look out for number one, as opposed to, what can I contribute to everyone else? You're not going to have a statue in the square about you if you are selfish. All of the people that get a statue in the square, it's because they rose above the selfish demands and achieved a selfless conception. They made a selfless contribution, whether it was as a general or it was as a helper, as a midwife. But it's all relative to your selfless contribution. But we're in a society that's teaching and breeding selfishness.
Yes.
So we have multitudes of issues. We can look at the whole situation that's happening on the planet, planetary, geological, etc. We can take a look at the financial situation. We can take a look at a host of different things plaguing society or under inspection by society or altering right in front of society. But all of those are all temporary issues. It's like going back and saying, well, when I was a child, I really wanted a red bike. Not a bike. I wanted a red bike. And it was so vital and so important at that time. But now you look at it and go, gosh, it didn't really matter. Well, if you raise yourself to your divine perspective of life, you realize that most of the issues that happen in your life aren't really as important as you make them or you're told that they are. And the real important issues is, what is developing in your consciousness? Are you getting above worrying about you and your survival? Are you actually trying to help others reach their divinity and become better beings? Are you trying to pass on truth and knowledge and support and encouragement only? Or are you guilty of passing on information that is not knowledge?
Yes, well, this is where it all gets very, very grey area, because from my perspective, we hit 7.8 billion human beings about 2 months ago on this planet. So 7.8 billion souls sharing breath at this moment. And we are, in many ways, we're a global family that don't realise that we're a global family, because we've got into differences, as you've said, and we need to be able to actually see that we all share the same breath, and that in many ways we have got far more in common than we have in differences.
Exactly.
And let's endeavour to come together and pull the strings of community together wherever
well,
we are.
That's where the situation is. That is what's coming to a head. We have leaders, if you want to call them that. Let's say we have a group, a small group, with an alternative plan that is based on them being rewarded for farming us. And then we have us, and our attitude is one of cooperative compassion. But that cooperative compassion is being discredited, it's being abused, it's being neglected, it's being marginalized at every turn by those that control the food, the money, the gas, the communications, the information. So it's leaving people going, I don't get it, because what they feel within their heart and what they see is needed within the society is not being supported. It's being the opposite. It's being challenged. It's being criticized. It's being abused. It's being exploited at every turn. And this is the awakening. This is what's happening. You have 50 different issues that are all part of the same issue. The real issue is, are we going to become divine, selfless beings and care and share and help? Or are we going to fight and struggle and hassle over what we perceive to be as differences? And this is what is going to make the difference. The consciousness of the humans is changing. Are we going to change it to the better? Well, I believe we are. But I believe there's going to be a lot of people that have to give up on what they've been trained and accept what they feel and know, intuitively know, to be right.
I hear you. I mean, the program that's been running for years, as you know, I don't have TV, I don't have a radio, so I've been able to be free of that. 5 years ago, I went up and I spent a month in Russia with a whole lot of people in Russia, and I didn't come across an American or an Australian or a Canadian or an Englishman. I was right away from everything, and all we did is work together. We made mud straw bricks, etc. We did buildings there. We had all sorts of games. We had dance. They had all sorts of cooking. We all shared and everything. And, I mean, I couldn't even speak Russian, but the whole thing was is that they all worked in unison for a better today and tomorrow. And the kids were just fantastic. And so there we are.
That's exactly what we are missing. They're trying to take away our kids. They're trying to control their education. They're trying to inoculate them with poisons. The same thing with the people. They're forcing you to go to work umpteen hours a day and half of Saturday. They're pushing the whole disintegration of the family unit. They're pushing contamination of the food and the water and the air. They're doing everything contrary to healthy human life. And this is the awakening that has to happen. This is the awakening that we all can agree on. Our plan is to advance civilization, advance our understanding, advance our love of God, if you will, advance our contributions. And what is happening? Everybody's being forced to look at you racially or some other socialism, when none of that is productive. And that's what we're facing. We have a group that's trying to keep us from organizing and understanding how great we can be and how powerful we are if we see each other as brothers and sisters under a divine father.
The whole thing is that we are the grassroots. We are having to build up from the bottom because the top of the pyramid shapes the whole pyramid. And
exactly. We need to build an alternative system and let the old one dismantle itself, because they are driven by greed and they will eat themselves when we stop providing them. They will disintegrate their own structure out of their own craziness when we stop cooperating with it. So we don't have to fight the system. We have to abandon it. We have to look at how can we provide our own food, our own standards? How can we get the government out of our pockets? How can we get the selfish people out of the council? We have to bring it back to what is the basic common sense requirements for humanity to grow healthy and intelligent and faithful.
Yes, I agree.
I meet people all the time. I get calls all the time, and they're coming to the same point. Yeah, I see this is wrong. Boy, and I hate that, and I'm so angry about this. But when you say, well, what do you think is the solution? They cannot answer. They have not been trained. They have not focused and analyzed the situation in depth to be able to say to you, we need to do this, we need to do that. And if you stop and look at it, we have the ability, within different people from different points of view, we have the ability and resources to reconstitute society on a natural, sustainable platform. But we're being told, no, you can't. You have to follow our system. But we all know now, and it is becoming more and more obvious, that their system leads to our demise.
I hear you very clearly. Yes, the other day I met a married couple, and they were just talking. They were very sort of upset and mixed up about things going on. And then I said, look, when you lift yourself up and realize and see yourself as a spiritual being having an earth experience.
Yes.
She just said, wow, I haven't looked at it that way.
Well, that should be trained at 7 years old.
Yes.
Every living entity should realize I'm the eternal living entity in a temporary body and act accordingly. And the whole situation, all of the perspectives and all of the varieties of issues we're facing will be plain and simply solved, because you have the right format for judgment. And we're not judging from the eternal spiritual platform. We are judging from the temporary. I mean, like 6 months ago or 2 years ago. People have such memory problems now, they can't tell you what they were doing 1 year ago today.
I hear you. Yes. And this is very important, because they're filling themselves up with stuff, irrelevant stuff.
Well, that's the goal. That is the goal of the system, to keep you in irrelevance.
Yeah, well, you see, turn off your TV. I can't believe it. The people who watch all these crime and these macabre and these grotty movies every night, they take all that stuff to bed with them when they sleep, and it's eroding your psychology as you sleep, and you have restless sleep.
So what you need to do is you look at it very objectively. They are putting that stuff on television. They are putting similar stuff in the news. They are putting that stuff in society. They are locking down and restricting your free will, your freedoms, your education. This is not an accident. They have a plan that is anti-human development. And the people have to realize that. At that point, we all share the agreement. It's just like the stuff that's coming out about human trafficking. Nobody approves of it, but we're not aware of it. But when anybody becomes aware of it, they go, I agree, it's wrong. So there's platforms that we naturally as humans abhor, and we have to recognize that the system that we're living in is an anti-human system. And then we realize, well, wait a minute, we're all in the same boat then. You take the concept that they want to depopulate. All right, let's say they want to depopulate 8 out of 10. Everybody who's thinking about that will say, it's the other 8. Yes. I'm not one of them.
Yeah.
But actually, it doesn't matter. The depopulating 2 is as bad as depopulating 8. The issue is, are we going to allow this system to be anti-human, or are we going to walk away from it and recognize our brothers and sisters and formulate the real human society? Because that's the only solution.
Well, I can only speak from experience. I naturally grow as much of my own food as I can. I source the best water I can, non-sanitized. I don't have anything to do with municipal system. I'll go and get the best water I can. I'm making choices, Roy. And I, this is, and the other day I saw a lovely woman. She had her baby in her arm and she came to where I worked. There's a, what you call a public kitchen in the holiday park. She's got a cardboard box of stuff. She opens it up. She pours it into a aluminium pot. She puts some tap water from the tap into it, stirs it around, and then she puts it into a plastic container, puts a lid on, puts it into a microwave oven and heats it up. And then later on, I see her lovingly give this stuff to her sweet little baby.
Right.
And what I cannot quite grasp is why loving mums, and where their husbands should be on the lookout for this, are eating stuff and they're killing their children or babies with kindness. I mean, I can't work it all out. Why can they not see the connection between things? The program is...
Because they've been blinded by someone of authority telling them it's okay. We have that problem. We are naturally servants. And we have the intent and we have the tendency to render service to others. And if we come upon some issue that we do not know the facts, we are lacking in knowledge, we will go to who we believe to be the authority to gain that knowledge. Well, now, if the authority is conscious and selfless, they will give you advice that will propagate, benefit, mature, nurture you. But if you go to a source that has an alternative anti-human plan, you become miseducated. And we have a society that, as you said a minute ago, they've been educating the human civilization for 75, 80 years directly with communication systems that we now modernly know. They've been miseducating humanity for 2 or 3 generations. So they think it's normal. They think it's natural. Because everyone else is doing it, they believe there's nothing wrong with it. But if they stop and look at it, well, what you put in the child was not pure, it was not clean, it was not safe. The microwave nuked it and caused all sorts of mess up. You put it in a plastic container, which all sorts of contaminations were added, et cetera, et cetera. And you turn around and you give it to the child thinking, I'm benefiting my child. Well, you're sustaining your child, but you're perverting their consciousness, their DNA, their aptitude to grow and inquire purely. And we have that now. We're 2 or 3 or 4, I don't know, generations down that track. And this is why a man who sees it correctly is most important to humanity. So they're pushing everybody into the rest homes and pushing disease into the rest homes because they don't want those people who see and could make a difference and could help and love others to get a microphone.
I hear you. Look, I've been to so many rest homes and I've seen them eat food there. Well, sorry, I've seen them
terrible.
Eat stuff and I cannot believe it. And I look into the kitchens there and I see all these unconscious workers doing their best, but I know that they're all overweight, nearly all overweight, shall I say.
Well, we have that, overweight and undernourished.
Yeah.
That's the combination. So this is another symptom of how humanity is a victim of a system that's anti-human. And our responsibility is to shake that off. We do not have the resources. We do not have the strength, the training, the education, etc., to fight it. But we do have the ability to walk away and adopt natural systems. And that's all we can do now. They run this planet. Greedy, crazy people run the planet, and they want to depopulate it so they can enjoy it more. But humanity deserves the right. God gave you independence and God gave you the essentials of life. We have justification and we have support from divine to be able to create and sustain a system that's not in their system, in their methodology of dehumanization. Now, how we implement that is multi-pronged because we have multiple issues to confront. So everybody, we need everybody on this team. We need the teachers. We need the women. We need the old men. We need the young people. We need everybody on the team of humanity. And we need to have them not looking for return, but looking to make a contribution such that their heart is enlivened, not their wallet.
I hear you. Look, the crew of Spaceship Earth.
Yes, yes.
7.8 billion human beings. The crew works for the benefit of the ship. And you're not finding the crew wanting to demand from other crew things that...
Yeah, give me your share.
Yeah, that's right.
No, here, take some of my share.
Yeah, well, you see, this is where we have to realize that this magnificent planet has lent us a body. People can't put their head around that one yet, Roy. It lends us free air, free rainwater, and until recently a free food chain. Everything we get is free. The ancient Greeks said, from Mother Earth, all things that are issued come from her.
Yes. She is the mother, God is the father, and we are the children. It's a very simple equation, but we're neglecting all of it. We're neglecting the mother, we're neglecting the father, and we're neglecting our siblings. Well, that's not inhuman. That is not human nature. That is an artificial perspective that we have been trained to. And what's happening is that people are realizing this isn't working. This isn't sustainable. I'm not happy. And because of those influences on their personal lives, people are coming out of the follow along blindly don't ask to where do I ask? Who do I ask? How do I get out of this complex situation? What is sustainable? What is going to make me feel good inside? And this, what I believe, is the moment in history for us all to come together. Yes, we have to reject the other system, and everybody's focusing on that. But as soon as they're done with that, or as soon as it starts to break down and lose some of its grip over humanity, they need honest answers. And those answers are going back and showing respect to the Mother Nature who gave you your body and all you require. Go back and show love to God for the consciousness that you have and the opportunity and the selfless mentality you're born and gifted with. Go back and become a good brother to your sisters and brothers. We have to go back to that simplistic concept because it's the root of all the other things we require for a sustainable society.
Roy, I can go back many years ago because I was born here over 70 years ago, and I came from a rural sector, and the rural sector always worked together, particularly farmers. Farmers mm-hmm. next door, each. We used to help each other put in hay, in silage, etc. It was a team spirit. Everyone would work, and Mum would come down with all sorts of food and drink, and you know, she'd be baking all day to make sure that the workers had a wonderful feed. And so we were cooperative all the time. New Zealand was actually built on cooperatives.
Yes, sir.
And this is the key, and we have lost that. Since 1984, when the Fourth Labour government came in, it was infiltrated, and the whole thing is they sold off all our crown assets, which were owned by the people. Any young one today doesn't understand that. New Zealand used to own itself hugely in those days. But then when the neoliberal game plan came in, that's right, they came in and they told us to sell off everything. Air New Zealand, the railways, they sell off
because it was a method of theft. It was a cover of theft. They took an asset that was worth $1 billion and sold it to one of their mates for a quarter of that, and left the people without the resource. And then their mate, who got this magnificent resource, charged us. We shouldn't have to pay a cent for power. We paid for and built all of the power systems here, and they generate power and only need maintenance. We should get it free. So many things. The food, the water. The water's not protected. The government's making a three-pronged approach at water right this minute. They're trying to take care of fresh water, storm water, and wastewater. And yet they're not taking care of any of it. They're contaminating the fresh water. They're not decontaminating the wastewater. And they're not making any use of the storm water. So the basics of their proposal is deception. And it's another level of exploitation. They exploited us out of our, let's say, mechanical or practical developments, the hydro plants and the highways and bridges and all that, they screwed us out of that and the rail systems, et cetera, et cetera. Now they're trying to get to the actual natural resources themselves and screw us out of that, because they know that if we leave their system and we depend upon our Mother Earth, we can get by without them. So they're just continuing with their process of trying to tie up any options we have because they are anti-human.
I had a situation where I did an interview very recently about a month ago about New Zealand's water.
Mm-hmm.
Their overseas companies can come in from China and Japan. They've got three water plants down in Whakatane, which is close to a port, and they're taking billions and billions of water out of this country, out of the ground, and they don't pay 1 cent for any of that water. All water in New Zealand taken out of the ground is free, and so what they're doing is that we're giving it away to them to put in plastic bottles and take it up to China and Japan because they've ruined their water.
We don't care what they've done. They have to make their bed and lie in it. The point is we do not have leaders who are protecting us and our resources. That's where it's at. All the contracts and all of the wheres and the whos and whys and all of the export crap and everything that has to do with the influence externally is not the point. It's that domestically, we're being cheated out of the general assets given by God for the sustenance of the society. And that has to be stopped. I don't know what it means. I'm not going to say what we have to do. But my basic premise is don't cooperate with a system that is actually attacking you. And we have to recognize, wait a minute, we can work at that. But it's going to take a lot of important people to step up. Now, this is where Billy is at. He's saying, I'm an unwilling politician. But he's standing up because somebody's got to go to the halls of parliament or whatever and try to stop this insanity.
Oh,
and
you.
The same thing has to happen with you. You're right here on the radio, and you're propagating truthfulness. You're propagating an awakening. You're propagating an awareness of our real predicament such that we can start to solve it. And we need to, all of us, look at how can we make a contribution to the awakening.
Well, I know one thing. Get off talkback radio. This program comes out of a sky tower. It covers over 1.6 million people in this whole area, and I'd love to be able to have more people tune into it, but there's so many people wanting to listen to their favourite jock who expresses their own biases and prejudices so that they find themselves locked into a dualistic situation when in actual fact we wanted to bring through some answers.
What you're saying is that the people are subjected to mind control techniques, and they can't walk away from something that's not actually feeding them. If you look at talkback radio as we despise it, it's all anticipation. You keep anticipating they're going to say something that matters, and they listen and listen and listen, and they go to break, and they come back, and they talk to somebody else, and they have 25 commercials, and they talk about something else, and they mix in a new subject, and you're just waiting and anticipating that they're going to give you some droplet of knowledge, and they never do. And what you're addicted to is the anticipation. You're not actually getting knowledge. You might even get a little bit of information, but you have no knowledge that's going to change your heart, change your awareness, change your values, give you support. And the people aren't aware of this because in time, by going through that process of anticipation, you become addicted. It's a type of hypnotism.
Yeah.
And the other type that we run into is the idea of an event takes place and there's 10 particular facts that describe the event. The media sits back and go, how many of these 10 factors should we publicize? And they'll publicize 3, 6, 7, 9, whatever, but they'll spin it and they'll project it so that you come to the conclusion they want you to come to. And after 10 years, 20 years, 50 years of this method, the people don't know knowledge anymore.
That's right. Well, this is a dumbing
it's
down process.
It's a mind control technique.
It's dumbing down, and I know people, when they look at Shortland Street, they look at Coronation Street, neighbours close to home, all they're watching all the time, essentially, is betrayal and revenge.
That's, yes, and mind control to accept it as human nature.
That's right. And they said it all
up. Human nature. Human nature is compassionate, truthful beings. If you're not truthful, if you're not compassionate, you've not reached the human platform. You're still fiddling around with envious animal mentality.
You got it. Oh, gosh.
So we're in a predicament where this animalistic propensity and mentality can't get us where we're going.
I agree, to the degree that if you look at the Sphinx on the Giza Plateau in Egypt, what that's showing is a human head on an animal body. We have to raise ourselves from the animal lower cause up to the human cause, and that's the riddle of the Sphinx.
Well, it's not a riddle. It's a plain common fact. If you don't come above your selfishness and your personal perspective and come to a universal brother and sister concept and come to respecting love of God as a goal to be achieved in the human form of life only, you are stuck in animal consciousness.
Yeah, well, you see, the other side of this coin, too, is that New Zealanders and Australians, too, we're quite locked down in our body. We see our physical, and as youth, we think we're bulletproof, blah, blah, blah. And it's only when we have an out-of-the-body or near-death experience where we're floating above our body and we're seeing the doctors working on us, or we're outside the vehicle in a car crash, then we realize this, that we are far more than our body. And Rupert Sheldrake talks about this.
Well, I believe that those type of experiences are at the extreme end, where someone needs a darn good shake to make them come out of their bodily conception and selfishness. But I believe it can be achieved by a saner section of society who's actually looking at the facts. What is my predicament? What is the situation? How can I grow as a person? And they will come to the right conclusion. They will hear by inquiring, sir, what do you think is the right thing to do in this predicament? And if they meet an honest man, they'll get good advice and they can awaken. So the person who's not selfish insanity, he can be awakened by reason and by knowledge. And the person who is lost to reason and knowledge, he will have an event, such as out of body, such as car crash, such as, well, I don't know what. But this is where God and nature are at. If you can be corrected and encouraged and supported with a minimal amount of influence, then that's what happens to you. But if you have to be shaken up some dramatic event, then it will happen to you. The whole intent is that our cooperative relationship as living entities is to assist one another in the awakening. And that means when I meet you and you meet me and anyone else, we must be honest to each other. And that helps us to awaken, because all human beings are an accumulation of the facts they have derived through their life and experience, either by association, by hearing, by experience. But they collect the facts and they gradually reject the deception. And we've come to the point where we have been subjected to so many years of deception in the education system and in the communication systems of our planet that we're having trouble refocusing on how to discern.
I agree, because most people, I'm feeling unwell, so they go to the doctor and they ask the doctor for all sorts of drugs and prescriptions.
That makes it worse.
Yeah, that's right. And so what happens then, our addictions kick in. And so there's millions and millions of dollars being poured into New Zealand. I can't believe I'm hearing so many people and friends who've got children on depressants or antidepressants. I mean, what's going on here? Well, what's going on here is that I'm talking with Roy Harlow of rushfm.co.nz, that the human race have got a choice. We either wake up or further our journey into a comatose situation. And truly, I don't want that for you.
It's an anti-human movement. They're not saying, oh, let me help you. They're saying, take this, with a twinkle of deception in their eye. We're in the situation that humanity must take care of itself. We must turn toward either scriptural or spiritual instruction. We have to turn out of this dependency upon a system we know to be anti-human. And that means we have to turn to a God-based system where God's intention is all good for humanity. but he does not violate free will. So we have to educate ourselves such that we use our free will as intelligent beings. And the powers that be, let's call them, that is the opposite of what they want us to do. And many, many things that look confusing can become clear as a bell when you take it from that perspective. They don't want you to be your best, highest, divine self and love God and your brothers, because they want you to be subordinate to them. And we're in that situation where the people are finally going, subordinate to you isn't working.
And it isn't. I mean,
no. That's what's really happening in society, is that the truth is getting around the media, and it's getting to the people, and the people are talking the truth back and forth, and they all inherently hear that truth, and they're going, I can't accept the media anymore.
Right, and Jacinda's own words, she and the New Zealand government are now to be the one source of truth about COVID-19 information. And
how did a government become a source of truth? Everybody and their brother goes, politicians always lie. Well, how can they declare themselves to be the source of truth then?
I agree.
Their tattoo is lying. That's what politicians do. They promise something and don't do it. That's the description of a politician. Yet now they're saying, trust me. Well, this is the same old rhetoric. Who do we trust? We have to trust God. We have to trust God's representative. We have to trust the honest man. We have to trust the selfless man. If we aren't going to trust there, we will become victim to someone, what's her name, that says, I'm the only authority. This is what tyrants say for centuries and centuries and centuries and centuries. You do what I say, you'll be better off. And it doesn't work out that way.
I know. It's just getting in talking with your neighbor and just sitting down for a while and being more vulnerable in front of your neighbor as well, if you can do that. And say, well, look, I haven't got all the answers. Where can we go? Have you heard of something? Because just yesterday, a woman said, oh, Tim, I never knew her, but she came out and she said, have you seen the video Plandemic? And I said, oh, Plandemic. I'm hearing lots of people talk about this. And she said, yeah, well, it's been shared amongst the mothers in this group here. And again, they are starting to realize that the conversation that they are getting from the news or the news that they're getting is not benefiting society. It's putting fear in. And this is the big thing.
Yes.
Fear, 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 fear. And what about love? Where's love come into this? Well, I mean, holy gee, when you sit still and be thankful and start breathing deeply into your being, your inner candle can ignite once again and you actually glow. And I think this inner glow needs to be able to be forthcoming.
Well, I agree with you in the sense that we are divine parts and parcels of God. And God is all good qualities personified. So we have all those divine qualities. It's whether we nuff them or stifle them by our bodily conception, or whether we nurture them by our spiritual conception. This goes back to the scriptures on the planet. The real scriptures on the planet all say the same thing. They are all of the answers humanity is looking for. But they're being tampered with as fast and as hard as possible for the longest period of time. I have a friend of mine who we have very good discussions, and he is coming to me saying he was working with something about the Bible he was working on discussing. And I said, I have a problem with the Bible that I can believe whatever Jesus says. And I'm very comfortable and I'm very enthused by what he says. But what I read in the Bible oftentimes contradicts him, and it leaves me going, I can't follow this. I can't accept this. And there's many scriptures that have had that happen. And he said, well, there's a thing called the Red Line Bible. And I said, I've never heard of that. And he says, they have a Bible. It's in color. And what Jesus said is in red. And then they give you sometimes explanations, and that's in another color. And then they have the regular text, and that's in another color. So that you can go through and actually see, hear, read what Christ said and give some support from realized souls in the next explanations. And then you realize how much of the other stuff has been altered for selfish purposes. And I agree so much with that, that if we go to any of the scriptures, I follow the Vedas, the Vedic literature. And the Vedic literature is the same thing. Our spiritual master says, my credit is that I did not deviate. And I believe that about the Bible. The credit of the Bible is the portions that's not been altered. And yet society is being bombarded with organizations that present a different interpretation of what Jesus says. And I don't believe we can get healthy like that, because this is what our society is. We have a different interpretation of the news, of the information, of the activities, of the goal of life. All of these things are being altered, changed, confused, obliterated. And we have to go back to the root, the person, the source. And if we go back to that source, there's no problem getting the answers. They're there. They've been there all along waiting for you to want them.
There's the Scofield Bible, and the Scofield Bible is...
well, created for deception.
Thank you. Now, people, listen to this. Look out for the Scofield Bible. If you haven't heard about it, then it'll just prove what Roy has been telling us.
Well, this is happening. They are infiltrating all religious movements on the planet to try to reduce their potency, because the potency is there, and it is their biggest counter movement. Truth is the counter movement to the deception, and they're well aware of that. They are well aware that they're deceiving us. They are happy about it, proud of it, skilled in it. So their method of defense is to destroy real knowledge. We talk about history has been changed. We talk about definition of words has been changed. We talk about history of society. We talk about political correctness. We talk about a host of things that they're constantly altering so that we're not standing on a firm platform of truth, knowledge, and faith. And yet, that's the only thing that's going to get us through this. We have to be truthful to each other. We have to be faithful that what we require is here. We have to understand that knowledge has always been here since the creation started to help humanity do the right thing. And yet, that is what they're attacking and destroying. So we see a society that is, it's like at loose ends, a boat without a rudder.
Thank you, because I want to jump in here. I've got a friend who's got a big, thick, old St. James Bible. And in it there, at the time of Christ, it says... and astrologers came from the East. Then, after subsequent printings, it turned into, and the three magi came from the East. And then finally it came to, now the three wise men. And we get more and more away from it until finally the three Coca-Cola salesmen show up at your door. And I know, but this is what's happening. Yeah. And I mean, I'm talking to so many people, and to get it, we have to realize everything has been infiltrated. There's an old saying,
yes,
infiltration instead of invasion.
Yes, and that's kind of a catchphrase that's going around right now.
Yes.
Because it does kind of sum up the deception, and it helps people to get out of the deception. Oh, wait a minute, they've infiltrated. We have collaborators in every desk, in every office of government, at every level. They're of a mindset, and they are hiring, and they're installing, and they've been doing it for 50 years, the people that propagate their plan, their system. And yet that system is constantly costing us more money, taking us more time, confusing us, illogical, impractical, etc., 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 to destabilize us from taking down their system.
That's
now,
right.
I personally am advocating that as of now, their system is so widespread, it would take an invasion, an army, a war, whatever, a revolt, to end their system. Or we can walk off and start building our own. Work within their system to build an independent system. I believe that is the peaceful solution.
Yes. I've been working to bring people together in different communities up and down New Zealand, because if you work with the farmers market, that is a place where you can network. That's where you can get good, fresh, I trust, organic food. And then you can build out from there, because there's so many people wanting to have good food and good conversation.
Well, I agree with that, but I think the more urgent issue is to find the truth, to weed out the deception, the purposely pasted together and painted pretty deception that's out there. That's what we must first do. We're surviving, we're eating, we're carrying on. Yes, we have too much disease, too much confusion, etc., but the knowledge is what is required now. Truthful knowledge, so that we can see things in proper perspective. Everything else we will be able to change if our perspective is correct.
Yep, I agree there. And so how can we, when we look at a human being, see, I see people now not as a male or female, not as black as white, I see them as a being.
Well, that's the point. This is probably one of the first steps that has to happen. The people need to stop seeing the differences. There is a statement called, reality is inconceivably, simultaneously, one and different. That is the reality perspective of life. You and I, we are the same. We are both men. We are both educated. We are the same particular age group. So many similarities. But yet, we're different. If you hit your hand with a hammer, I don't feel it. So we are individuals, but we are of the same construction, same nature. If we can simply see that in proper perspective and accept the duality that both of those exist at the same time, if we can do that, we will see things in proper perspective. We can see, they can apply that to 1,000 different aspects of our life. And we can say, all right, there's all these differences, but there's all these similarities too, and they coexist simultaneously. What are you going to focus on? We're all trained to see the differences. And it's not working.
Go.
Then we must look at the similarities, because the similarities stimulates our humanity. Because when you see, oh, that person's hunger is as painful as my hunger, is as painful as the next person's hunger, then we develop compassion, and that stimulates our humanity, because humans are compassionate. And we're seeing that the compassion of humanity is being misdirected to PC trivialities instead of being attracted to or focused on the development of a system that sustains compassion.
Okay, very good. Can you take it further on that one? Because I think we're getting into a place where we've got to make this real super connection with the heart of humanity.
The humanity side of things is when we reflect the divine qualities of God that are naturally in us. If we go ahead and reflect compassion, truthfulness, honesty, caring, sharing, these type of characteristics, those are the divine qualities that are inherently our nature. All of the other lower characteristics are generated by the body. Generated by the temporary incarnation, if you will. And yet, as I said earlier, you cared so much about the color of your bike when you were a child, but now you realize it didn't really matter. Well, at the time of death and you have to leave, you look back at the whole life.
Yes.
And you see so much of what I did didn't matter. And you look at, well, what I should have done, or what I wish I'd have done, or what I could have done, and that's what you need to do now. Because that's what will make your heart full. That's what will give you relief, so that at the time of death, it's not an anxiety, it's a satisfaction. I did the best I could. I did make a positive contribution. I reflected my divine Father's will.
That's right. And I gave, and I cooperated, I worked, I helped. I did all these little things at the time, and now I can say, yes, I'm glad I made that decision.
Yes. So it's that, what's that phrase, who said it, but he said, will you look back on your life and say, I wish I had, or I'm glad I did?
Yes, I'm glad I did is the way to go, because I know.
Exactly. But we have so many people that are going day to day fighting and struggling for existence, for the necessities of life, and thinking that they're in competition with the next guy. And this is the plan of a system that's breaking. The people need to go back to the root of it all, the selfless root of it all, the divine root of it all, the heartfelt love and compassion for others.
Yeah, well, you see, I mean, my age group now, 70s, mid-70s, etc., we've had our cake and eat it too. New Zealand has been one of the most gifted places for us to be able to have a life.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And I've definitely had my cake and eat it, and what I'm wanting to do is share as much cake as I can before I lift off. And
the problem is that the system has depleted the natural resources and depleted the natural compassion of the humanity simultaneously, to where there has to be a correction first. Then New Zealand can heal, because the people will stop killing a tree just because it puts leaves in their gutter. They'll recognize it gives fruits and flowers and shade. They'll realize it gives habitat. They'll stop doing things that they're selflessly impelled to do, and they'll start doing things that are selfless and will instigate the regeneration we require. The regeneration of nature, the regeneration of our environment, the regeneration of our family unit, the regeneration of our love. And, of course, the regeneration of our love of God.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'd like to think that New Zealand could turn a new page.
It can. I completely think it can. I don't have a doubt about it at all. It's a matter of us going through the turning point. We have to, like I say, disconnect from their system as much as we can and try to establish a sustainable system of our own. And it will prevail because their system is being propagated by them. But when they're caught out as being criminal and anti-human, they'll abandon it and run. And they'll abandon us. And their system and their infrastructure will collapse. We have to have the intelligence, the fortitude, and the foresight to be able to restart it and reamalgamate it into our own system of sustainability based on selfless contribution.
Yeah, well, you see, I've been also in lots of communities in my life, and I know you wake up in the morning and you'll volunteer to work in the kitchen. And so you go into the kitchen, and there's a whole group of you, about 5 to 7 or 10 of you, and you're all doing your job of cooking, you're laughing, having a good time. And then it's like I was at a place up in Scotland, and we used to go out into the garden, and we used to have a prayer out in the garden because we realised that the garden produce
was giving its life to sustain you.
That's right. And so we had the blessing. We saw that as God's light, particularly the
nature's bounty.
That's right. The photons that were in the sun 8 minutes ago were now stored into all those greens. So yep. We took all the greens into the kitchen. And then what we did is we were able to cut them and put them into pots or bowls and make sauces or dressings, etc. We actually made a wonderful, gigantic meal for everybody. But when we did this, we realized that this is what we were doing. We were actually making a presentation of all this magnificence from the garden, and we blessed it all from our heart. And then we were taken into the dining room where everybody came in to eat, and we stood in a circle, and we blessed all this lovingly produced produce, and was all tastily prepared for those who came to eat it. And then we ate this light, we ate this love, we ate this goodness. And so what we did is we ended up expressing this love and goodness.
Man should not eat without giving it to God first in his heart. Let it be blessed by God's acceptance. Eat food that's spiritually sanctified. This will purify the consciousness and the heart. And this is what we need to do. We need to analyze what are the methods whereby we can raise our vibration and turn the materialistic experience into a divine experience. As I was saying earlier, those qualities and characteristics are naturally in all of us. They're simply covered like a blanket over a fire. If we learn how to uncover it by spiritual, transcendental, selfless, divine dedication and devotion, we can purify ourselves such that our consciousness becomes clear and the path forward becomes obvious and the solution becomes self-evident and we work as brothers and sisters, success is guaranteed.
Yes, well, how I see it, we are here to spiritualize matter.
Yes, and you have to be empowered to know how to make that transition. We don't have the potency to turn matter into spirit, but we do have the potencies to induce the Lord to please do that for me.
Well, it's all about connection. We are a conduit between heaven and earth, and we've forgotten about it.
Yes, because we're under pressure. We're under attack constantly by this anti-human system we live in. You have to work. You have to do this. You have to do that.
And we've got
so
more laws.
We're constantly distracted from our divine responsibility that comes with being a human.
Well, that's right. Well, when we realize our sanctity, we don't want to hurt anybody. We don't want to steal. We don't want to take or lie. All we want to do is harmoniously work for the betterment of the community, the betterment of the whole. And so we carry that intent with us. Intention is everything as far as I'm concerned.
I agree with you. It's the intent with which you do something that God notices. Your karma is determined not by the act, as the intent of the act. It's just like the knife in the hand of the surgeon. It cures your life, and in the hand of the criminal, it takes your life.
That's right. That's
so
right.
What is your intent? Is your intent selfless love of God, or is your intent selfishness at any cost? So how you handle your intent, how you train your consciousness, how you perceive your duty and responsibility in this life is vital. That's what I said a moment ago. Knowledge and the perspective must come first for us to be able to build a new, workable, sustainable system.
It's going to happen no matter what. We're going to work on it because there's lots of people out at the moment who realize that we have to make this great turnaround. We have to do it, and we have to do it now.
This is what they're calling the Great Awakening.
That's right.
At this point, the awakening is to the fact I have to change.
Yes. Yeah.
As yet, they don't all know, well, I don't think any of us all know, what that change constitutes because it's individual. But we can all perceive, I cannot go on with what I'm doing because it's not sustainable.
Amen to that.
So this is where you and Green Planet FM have a wonderful opportunity, have a wonderful possibility of nurturing that inquisitiveness.
That's right. Well, I mean, the whole thing is curiosity. Children and babies, all babies and children are curious.
But oh, are they ever?
But by the time they get to an adult, as you say, they're programmed and they're locked in. And
well, you said a moment ago that there's so many people that have their children on types of drugs, and that is exactly why they're on those drugs, is to remove that curiosity, individualism, and inquisitiveness.
I agree.
That's what they do. They dumb them out, dull them out, so they aren't inquisitive. The kid that's going around, why, he's a pain in the ear, pain in the butt.
But
because you have so many questions you have to answer, and sometimes you're struggling, but the growth rate of that child is astonishing because he's absorbing all of these answers.
Yes.
And we, as humans, we're supposed to be inquisitive. We're supposed to want to know why. And they're not answering anymore. The school system is such a mistake. It's such a problem now that so many great, powerful, intelligent, wonderful beings are not getting a chance.
That's right. Well, look, you go out on a starry night away from the city. If you're at a beach a long way away from town or out in the countryside and it's a clear night, put something down on the ground and lie down there and look into the galactic vault. You will see the magnificence of it, and yet there are some horrible scientists who talk about, oh, the universe is going to collapse. The end of the world is going to happen in so many billion years' time. They have no idea. I want to state this. I remember I was in China when I heard that the Australian astronomers asked and got hold of a lot of astronomers worldwide to focus on 1% of the night sky, and so they put all their telescope power down this 1%, and they came to the conclusion that there are 10 times as many stars in the universe as there are grains of sand in every desert and beach on this planet. And these egotistical scientists turn around and say, oh, the universe is going to end sometime. This is part of the program. They are
yes,
here.
Yes, it is. Yeah. It's part of the deception. Yes, it is.
Yep.
Yes, it is.
Roy,
we have the ability to make ourselves pure. We have the ability to understand the right from wrong and do the right.
That's for real. Roy, we've come out of time, brother, but I want to be able to say thank you for expressing yourself so profoundly and lovingly. And I want to fall back on the word namaste, because to me it connected so deeply. It's always been a Hindu greeting and a farewell. And for some unknown reason, particularly after the British, who got a toehold 300 years ago in India, they took away namaste as a goodbye. But anyway, namaste. I honour the light behind your eyes. I honour the God, the Atman, within you. And I just want to say, as a farewell, I want to honour the light behind your eyes and the God or Atman within you. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Tim, and I honestly respect your contribution. I see it as a selfless one, and I think it's a great example. Whether you change the world or you change one man, the intent in you is pure, and I respect that, and I'm grateful. I appreciate getting a chance to speak on your show, and I hope that the people listening see your contribution and respect it like I feel it.
Thank you, brother. Thank you so much.
No problem. Thank you.
That was Roy Harlow of rushfm.co.nz. I invite you to be able to come to greenplanetfm.com, where we have over 500 interviews in our database, which you can readily download and listen to be able to inspire yourself to become the change you want to see in the world. And become involved in caring for your children and grandchildren's future. We are also on Facebook, on Green Planet FM, and ourplanet.org. Please come and love us. This is Tim Lynch, in the spirit of Aroha, wishing you a wonderful week. We look forward to being with you next week. I say, Kia kaha and haere rā.